Let's continue the wonderful and never-ending APS-C versus full-frame discussion, because it seems like there's still a lot of confusion and I want to try and clear up a few things. I also know that a lot of you are thinking about upgrading to full-frame because of the supposedly better dynamic range, but is that true? Are you gonna get more dynamic range by upgrading to full-frame? Just like that. I can already tell you that it's not a yes or no answer. It's not so black or white. There are many shades of gray in between. Get it? Dynamic range? Shades? I'm sorry, just roll the intro. So what I want to do is, I want to show you actual images, side by side, APS-C, full frame, photos and video. No complicated graphs or numbers and no super technical explanations, because that just adds to the confusion and, you know, I also don't know all the technical details, so I'm gonna try to keep it simple. Okay, look, I have a budget APS-C camera, my Canon M50, and an expensive full frame camera. I'm recording this with my Sony a7S III, and these cameras will be my test subjects, and then hopefully by the end of the video, you'll understand why there's so much confusion around this topic, dynamic range. And maybe real quick, for all of you who don't know what dynamic range is, dynamic range is the contrast ratio between the darkest and brightest color tones that a camera can capture in a single exposure. It's measured in stops. The human eye can see about 20-21 stops, and camera sensors 11, 12, 13 on average. 15 is already really good. If your photos or videos always have shadows that are way too dark, almost black, or skies that are plain white, no detail, then it could be that your camera doesn't have enough dynamic range. It's not always the case, maybe you're using the wrong settings, but it's a possibility. Okay, now let's take a look at the numbers of these two cameras first. When I Google the dynamic range for both these cameras, I get 13.4 stops for the Canon M50 and 14, sometimes 15 for the Sony a7S III. And that's already a problem. There are always different numbers floating around. Because camera companies like to give you high numbers, but then the people who actually test the cameras, users, they end up with lower numbers, and then they call it usable dynamic range. It's normal. But when looking at the numbers, we can say that the Canon M50 APS-C has excellent dynamic range. The Sony a7S III is superb, it's above average. But yeah, so 13.4 stops for an APS-C camera, on paper, that's on the same level or even better than a lot of full-frame cameras that came out in the same year or later. The Canon R has 13.5 stops, the Canon RP 12 stops. So why is it then that so many people say that the Canon M50 is bad in the dynamic range department? And why do so many people generalize it? APS-C is horrible when it comes to dynamic range. Well, that's because we're talking about mirrorless cameras here. Cameras that shoot both video and photos. And a lot of times, there's a difference between, a big difference sometimes, between dynamic range for photos and videos. And that's because not all photo and video files are encoded the same. You've probably heard of RAW photos, JPEGs, 8-bit color, 10-bit color, 14-bit RAW files, SLOG3 color profiles, bit rates. I keep going, you know, there's a lot of stuff. But I promised that I was gonna try to keep it simple. So let's start with photography and dynamic range. And remember guys, I'm gonna say it again, it's a simplified explanation because I also don't know all the technical details. And my English vocabulary is a bit limited when I'm talking about technical stuff. Maybe you've noticed. A few days ago, I was watching a YouTube video about the Canon M50 and the guy was talking about how horrible the dynamic range is when he's shooting photos. And I couldn't believe it because I think the dynamic range is excellent. Photos look beautiful. But then I kept watching and eventually the monkey came out of the sleeve. That's a Dutch expression. Sounds great in English, right? The monkey comes out of the sleeve. Anyway, so the monkey was that the guy, claiming to be a photographer, never shoots photos in RAW, JPEGs only. I mean, yeah, sure, come on. So for all of you who don't know the difference, JPEGs are compressed processed files, and RAW files contain all of the sensor's data, all the color data, tonal data, and with all that data comes dynamic range. It's unprocessed. Shooting JPEGs is easier because you can select the picture style and that decides what your photo will look like, but if you want all the dynamic range, then there's no other way than to shoot in RAW and edit your photos yourself. So don't believe anyone who says that APS-C cameras by definition have horrible dynamic range. It depends. The Canon M50 for photography has great dynamic range. And I can prove it. I shot some high contrast photos with both my Canon M50 APS-C and my Sony a7 S3 full frame. Superb dynamic range. I exposed both photos for the highlights because in digital photography, it's easier to bring back detail in the shadows than in the highlights. And as you can see, the sky still has all the detail. Nothing is blown out, except for the sun, of course. But the bottom of the photo looks very dark, almost black. And we can say that both images look pretty much the same, right? Of course, there's a difference in resolution. The quality of the lenses is also not the same. But other than that, they're very similar. Because, of course, I also used the same exposure settings and both photos are shot in 14-bit RAW. And then I raised the shadows for both photos and boom, almost identical. The Canon photo, when you zoom in, you can see that there's slightly more noise and it gets slightly muddy, but it's definitely usable, guys. It doesn't look ugly. The Sony file, well, the Sony file looks super clean. So that's that one or two stops extra dynamic range. That's what you see here. It's a minimal difference. But now let's take a look at the 8-bit JPEGs. The JPEGs also look similar, but when I try to lift the shadows, the Sony file still looks okay-ish, but the Canon M50 file is completely destroyed, gone. And that's because they also both use different software algorithms and profiles and whatnot to create those JPEGs. Again, I don't know all the technical details, so if anyone can tell me, then put it in the comments and I'll pin that comment. But both JPEGs look a lot worse than the RAW photos. The RAW photos for both cameras are almost identical, almost. So APS-C cameras can have great dynamic range. In this case, there is a small difference, one and a half stop, I don't know. But that's also because the Sony a7 S3 is above average. But don't believe anyone who says that this APS-C camera has horrible dynamic range, because they don't know what they're talking about. I'm talking now specifically about this APS-C camera. Now, the important question, of course, is, are you willing to pay 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 bucks more for that minimal difference in dynamic range? Because the Canon M50 here is 600 bucks, the Sony a7S III, 3,500. And when it comes to photos, it's a minimal difference. There is a difference, I agree, but it's minimal. Is it worth that much money if you're not a professional photographer? It's up to you, of course. You can do whatever you want with your money, but if you want to upgrade just for the dynamic range, I don't know. Doesn't feel right. Seems like a lot of money for a tiny improvement. Again, that's just in the case of these two cameras, and specifically the Canon M50. Because not all APS-C cameras are as good as the Canon M50 here. Maybe your camera, your APS-C camera, has 10 stops of dynamic range, and then, of course, upgrading to a full frame or a better APS-C camera will be an improvement. This is where APS-C cameras usually have a problem, but it's not necessarily because of the sensor size. It's again because of encoding of the files. The Sony a7S III can shoot video in the S-Log3 color profile. It's not exactly the same as RAW video, but it's up there. It captures a lot of information, a lot of dynamic range. It's also 10-bit color and you can record at high bit rates. So there's a lot of information in that file. But then the Canon M50 in video mode shoots 8-bit video files at low bit rates. It also uses the same picture styles or color profiles as when the camera is in photo mode for JPEGs. And You saw the comparison. Dynamic range, it just plummets. Not because this is an APS-C sensor, and APS-C sensors by definition have horrible dynamic range, not at all. It's just because the camera companies don't allow the camera, the computer in there, to use the full potential of the sensor. Because there is dynamic range in that sensor, we saw the photos. So what you could say is that they limit this camera to shooting video in JPEG quality. That's a good way of putting it, I think. It's JPEG video. Why? Well, to keep the cost down, to keep APS-C cameras cheap, to protect their more expensive cameras. It's all about money, you know? Usually, full-frame cameras are more expensive and they get all the extras. 10-bit color, S-Log3, superb processing power, a better computer. But, you know, there are plenty of Super 35 or APS-C cinema cameras that beat most full-frame cameras when it comes to dynamic range. But the thing is, those cameras are super expensive. Did my light go out? Damn it. I don't like it, but okay. I really don't like it. I'm all confused now also. Where was I? Yeah, so, you know, I agree that full-frame cameras, because of their physical properties, because the size is bigger, I do agree that in general they have an edge. But as we all saw, it's dangerous to compare in general, because the Canon M50, photos, dynamic range is excellent. On the same level as a lot of full-frame cameras. Video. Well, you know, let's take these cameras out and I'll show you the difference between bad dynamic range in video and then the Sony excellent dynamic range. So I'm outside now in the shade and my face is exposed properly, I think, but you can see that the background is all blown out. And if I want to keep detail in the background, I'll have to lower the exposure, but then my face is gonna disappear. So that's what happens when you don't have a lot of dynamic range. You have to choose for either the highlights or the shadows. You can't have both. Now let's switch to the Sony a7 S3 and it should be better. You can see that my face is exposed the same as with the Canon M50. The background is also blown out, but a lot less. And if I lower the exposure now so that I keep the detail in the sky even, I think something like this, then my face still has some detail, it's not gone. So that's the difference between low dynamic range and high dynamic range. Here I can keep detail in the sky and even in my face in very harsh, contrasty conditions. Hair is getting really long here and it doesn't stick, it doesn't like stay in here. Is that annoying for you? For me it isn't. Okay, anyway, so guys, the point of this video is not to declare a winner. I just wanted to show you that full-frame cameras are not by definition better when it comes to dynamic range. Even if you compare two full-frame sensors, it could be that there's a big difference in dynamic range, several stops. So don't compare sensor sizes, but compare individual sensors if you're planning to buy a new camera. And when you say that your camera has bad dynamic range, are you talking about photos or video? Because there could be a difference. Are you shooting in RAW, S-Log? You know, JPEGs, it's all very important. But also the other way around, when camera companies throw a number at you, 14 stops, what does that mean? We saw now that the 13.4 stops of dynamic range for the Canon M50, I mean, is it lying? I don't know if it's lying, but it is confusing. 13.4 stops for photos, not for video. That's where all the confusion comes from. It's not necessarily the sensor size, but the technology behind the sensor. Okay, one last thing maybe. I do agree that if you need a camera that has a mirrorless camera that has 15 stops of dynamic range in both photos and video, you're probably gonna have to look at full frame cameras, because that's where the companies invest all their money and their technology. But I bet that they could make an APS-C camera that beats all full frame cameras. But it will most likely be a very, very expensive APS-C camera. Thank you so much for watching, guys. I hope it helps. I hope there's a little bit less confusion now. And as always, see you in the next one.